Welcome to Pleasant Green Sunday School. This is Lesson 5 for July the 2nd, 2017. We begin a new unit today, Unit 2, entitled Calling of Prophets. Our topic for today, taken from the Adult Quarterly, is entitled That's Not Fair. The devotion reading comes out of 2 Chronicles chapter 19, verses 4 through 7. Background scripture comes out of Exodus chapter 3, and we will be studying today from our print passage, Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 through 12. Our key verse reads, Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel has come unto me, and I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppressed them. Come now, therefore, and I will send thee unto Pharaoh, that thou mayest bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. That's taken from Exodus chapter 3, verses 9 and 10 from the King James Version. Our lesson aims today, number one, is to examine the details of how Moses was called and the self-revealed nature of God who called him. Number two, empathize with God's awareness of injustice and God's desire to correct it. And the third aim is to address injustice in ways that honor God's identity, His purpose, and His presence. We have three outlines today that are part of our lesson today. The first outline is entitled, Moses Sees a Burning Bush. The second outline is entitled, Here I Am. And the third outline is entitled, Who Am I? We certainly thank and praise God for this great privilege to be able to share this lesson with you today. We certainly thank and praise God for being able to present our Sunday school lessons to you where you can study along with us, and we hope that you have been following with us. We just completed a very comprehensive study of the book of Judges. And so now we're looking at the prophets. And so this is a very beautiful lesson, one that I'm sure that you are well familiar with. But we want to begin today with some background from the book of Exodus so we can have some perspective. And then we'll get along with our outlines for today. But the title of the book of Exodus is derived from the Greek word exodos. You can see some reference in Luke chapter 9 verse 31, which means exit or departure. The book takes its name from the central event of Israel's departure from Egypt, recorded in the book's first 15 chapters. So Moses' authorship of Exodus, we should date the book after the Exodus event, somewhere around 1450 to 1440 BC, and before the death of Moses, about around 1406 BC. So the book of Exodus carries forward the story of God's fulfillment of His promise to Abraham to bless him and make him a great nation. You can see some reference in Genesis chapter 12 verse 2, and it begins by referring to the descent of Israel into Egypt, Exodus chapter 1, verses 1 through 7. This connects through Genesis chapter 46, verses 8 through 27, and with the Genesis narratives. But the book concludes with Israel at Mount Sinai, where the tabernacle is completed. And so our biblical context in our lesson quarterly, the calling of prophets, looks at how God called various prophets at different times for specific purposes. Included in this unit are the calls and responses of Moses, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and also Amos. So we begin with Moses' call and response, and we will see a recurring theme for the responses of these Old Testament prophets, the phrase, "Here I am." So let's talk a little bit, just a little bit about a prophet. Some people view a prophet as one who predicts the future. That is certainly part of the Old Testament, of what the Old Testament prophets did. But their task was by no means limited to that. And it's helpful to see the prophets as both foretellers, those who predicted the future accurately, and forthtellers, those who declared God's truth. Prophets were often subject to verbal or physical abuse because they spoke unpleasant truth boldly and plainly, and they often did so without regard for the consequences. So it should be understood whenever typically that prophets appeared in the Old Testament, the times were not good. The people of God had strayed off course, and so God always historically raised up someone who would speak for him to the people, to help guide the people and to get them back on track where God would be pleased. And so the first five, or the Pentateuch, or the Torah, these books of the Bible are also under the heading of the law. And so we have obviously Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. So we hope that this is helpful for you, and as we study this law today, coming out of the second book of Exodus, of our Bible. So let's begin today with this first outline. Moses sees a burning bush. This is taken from Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. And the Bible says, "Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of the bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed." Verse 3, "And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burnt." And so if we look at the end of Exodus chapter 2, it seemed that Moses was destined to become a humble shepherd, far from the spotlight. Yet since God had heard the cries of his chosen people, we see that in Exodus chapter 2 and verse 25, God was preparing to call Moses to lead Israel out of Egypt. Chapter 3, we find Moses being positioned for greatness. Moses had been in Midian for 40 years and was now 80 years old. During this time, Moses had become the trusted son-in-law of Jethro, who was the devout leader and priest of his tribe. Jethro was a Midianite, descendant of Abraham's son Midian by Abraham's second wife, Keturah, and thus Moses' distant relative. As descendants of Abraham, they knew of the one and true living God. Moses led his flock to the far side of the wilderness, eventually coming to Mount Horeb or Mount Sinai, which is one of the 12 Palestinian mountains referenced in the Old Testament. It is sometimes called the Mountain of God. Mount Horeb was center stage in the history of Israel. It is not only where God would call Moses, but it is also the place where God gave Moses the Ten Commandments. You can see some reference in Exodus chapter 19, verse 20. Mount Horeb was only a short distance from the Red Sea, where Moses would eventually lead his people across on dry land. You can see some reference in Exodus chapter 14. So from a distance, Moses noticed an odd sight, a burning bush, probably a thorn bush, that was not consumed by fire. This piqued his curiosity. He did not know that the angel of the Lord was in the flames. And so we have to keep in mind that burning bushes were not an uncommon sight because of the extreme conditions, hot and dry. So Moses drew near the bush. He wanted to know why this bush was not consumed by the flames. And so we have some interesting perspective here about how God called Moses initially. The children of Israel, as you all know, were being greatly burdened in Egypt by reason of their taskmasters, and they had cried out to the Lord. If you go back over into the very first chapter of the book of Exodus, it talks a little bit about why the Egyptians and Pharaoh were they were afraid of the children of Israel because of how they were multiplying. And so Pharaoh subsequently ordered all the midwives to kill the male children to somehow prevent the growth process of the nation of Israel. But as we said earlier in some of our background, this dates back to a promise that God had made to Abraham that he would fulfill with the children of Israel, and that he would greatly, as he told Abraham, that he would greatly bless him and make him a great nation. And I don't know if Abraham fully understood the magnitude of the promises of God, but we can see in the first chapter of the book of Exodus that the children of Israel were greatly multiplying, and the Egyptians were afraid of them, that somehow they may rise up and overthrow them. And so this caused the children of Israel to go into bondage, to go into captivity. And so they began to cry out to the Lord. And so it's not quite clear that they even know that they are the children of God to the extent that God is going to bring them out. But I don't want us to miss the fact that a promise has been made. And it doesn't matter what our circumstances might be, because we're going to talk about that a little bit today, because this story, this narrative here, the entire book of Exodus is typical of the person and work of Christ, especially the tabernacle, the priesthood, and the sacrificial ritual, as we see in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, and also a good book to study about how Christ was the fulfillment of the Old Testament type would be the book of Hebrews. And so we want to understand here that it doesn't matter how difficult our circumstances might be. We want to make sure that we don't forget the promises that God have made to us. And so this is what is triggering the Lord to call Moses. And then as we get a little bit further on into this lesson, that God is going to send Moses to redeem his people, to bring them out, to deliver them because of the promise that he made through Abraham, through Isaac, and then through Jacob. And so this is a covenant relationship that God has with the children of Israel that he has established. And so we see the setting here in this first outline, how God used this situation to reveal himself to Moses. But the backdrop behind this is the fulfillment of a promise that God made to Abraham. I want us to keep that in mind. But we have a question here in the quarterly, have you ever had a burning bush experience which you saw or felt something divine? If so, how did you respond? But I want you to, when you have an opportunity, to go over into John chapter 4, I believe verse 23 and 24, and you will find over there that God is a spirit. We have to understand that. And then the Bible says that the Father seeketh those who would worship him in spirit and in truth. So my point is that God at some point is going to reveal himself to you, to me, to us, so we may be able to understand his personage and his character. And so this is what Moses is discovering in this experience here. It is a reality that he is having this encounter with God. The promises of God, they are our reality. This is what we live by. This is what we go by. This is where our hope is founded. It's in the promises of God. It's in the things that God has said he will do. And so this is this encounter that Moses is having with God. Moses is the instrument to secure or to effect this promise that God made through Abraham, now to covering the children of Israel. So we want to be able to appreciate this. Even as we said earlier, this is a type of Christ, and you can see you and I were saved through experience. Our revelation that we had of Jesus Christ may be different from Moses, but nevertheless, we have had a real experience, and the reality of it is that God is God. And so if you go on further into this account in Exodus chapter 3, we stop at verse 12. But if you continue on in that chapter, you will see the conversation between God and Moses. So our second outline is entitled, Here I Am. This is taken from Exodus chapter 3, verses 4 through 9. The Bible says, when the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, Here I am. Verse 5, Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face, because he was afraid to look at God. Verse 7, The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt, and I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites. Verse 9, And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So I want to read a little bit of this commentary, and then I want to talk a little bit about what this means for you and I today. But having gained Moses' full attention, God called Moses by his name from the burning bush. Without hesitation, Moses responded by saying, Here I am. Now we must admit that some of us would have quickly run away. Bushes do not normally speak. Yet Moses, no doubt, had already felt the call of God in his life. Even while in Egypt. I want you to look at Exodus chapter 2, verses 11 through 16. It appeared as though Moses wanted to come closer to the burning bush, but God directed him not to come any closer, because God's presence made the burning bush sacred. God further instructed Moses not to remove his sandals, so that Moses would have no doubt who was talking to him. God quickly told Moses who he was. He was the God of the three major patriarchs of the Israelites, Abraham, his son Isaac, and his grandson Jacob. And so I want to just stop right there. And so the reality of all of this is that God is God. And at some point, I've said this for years now, your faith should lead you to experience. When we read the things about God, and when we read the Word of God, and we believe that, you must understand that if you have faith in the gospel, you are going to have experience with God. You're going to have a real life experience, encounter with God. And so Moses is sharing with us today that this story is not just for him, but it's just for you. It's also for you because God is calling you. We talked about that in our study of the book of Judges. And so at least two specific calls that we dealt with was the general call, and that is unto salvation. And then we get into more specific or special calls in terms of what God would have you to do. But Jesus gave his life that you and I might be saved. He died so you and I could live a saved life, a life of hope and a life of promise. And so that's what this story is telling us. God is giving the children of Israel through Moses a deliverance, a new start, a fresh start in a different place, in a different environment, away from oppression and all of these other things that they were going through. And I just want to encourage you with this today, because God knows what you're going through. And your initial point of being saved, there has been multiple times in your life where God has stepped in again and again and again, and he's rescued you time and time again. And what God has done in this process with us is created a history for us to reflect upon, so when we get in trouble the next time, we have to pull out that history book and see where, if God did it then, he will do it now. He is not a God of or respect of persons, and so he doesn't take bribes, and he's not partial. And so, but we want to be able to appreciate this lesson, that this is our story today. All of us have been saved time and time again. And so these people, the children of Israel, they are now declared. God says, these are my people. I'm going to bring them out. So this is corporate here. And so he says, I love what he says to Moses here. God, he tells Moses, I've seen what they're going through. And I just thank God for that I don't have to try to tell him what's going on in every situation in my life, and I don't have to try to describe every detail. God knows what you are going through. God knows what I am going through. And so we just have to be encouraged today. And I'm sure the children of Israel thought that they would never get out of that situation. But here comes Moses, an 80-year-old man. Here comes God to the rescue. And God is ready in the third chapter of Exodus to bring his people. And mind you, they have been oppressed for years and years and years. But God is ready now to deliver them. And so Moses is having this experience. This is now his new start, that he has to become the spokesperson for God. I want to just make this point. It's very important that you know, while the Spirit of the Lord is reminding me about this, it's very important that you know what God wants you to do. It is critical that you know your purpose in life. It is critical that you know the direction that you need to go in, certainly at the hand of God. And that's what we want to be able to take away from this lesson today. We all have you've heard that term over the years. Folks would say that, you know, you have a call on your life, but all of us have a call on our lives. We have a general call. Jesus says these words, I believe, in Matthew chapter 11. He says, "Come to me, all ye that labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for my yoke is easy and my burdens are light." And so we have a call to answer in terms of what God has done in sending Jesus to save us, to deliver us, and to rescue us from the penalty of sin, the power of sin, and ultimately the presence of sin. God is going to remove us from the very presence of sin, and that's what keeps us holding on. And I know that you're going through, but I just want you to be encouraged today that God knows what you're going through, and He is concerned. I like that in this lesson that it's brought out, that God says He has seen the misery, and He says, "I'm concerned." Don't ever let the devil make you believe that God doesn't care about what you're going through. Keep those things in mind. But another question here in the quarterly is to discuss how you feel about the following statement. Many believe that God divinely delivered the Israelites from Egyptian slavery, as well as He did African Americans from slavery in the United States. So we want to always understand in each account, each historical account, since sin has entered the world through Adam, there will always be people that are going through, that are suffering at the hands of other individuals. God is a God of equity. God is a God of justice. God is a God of peace. And so our job, even as saints of God, is to be able to speak out and to speak up about injustices, because that represents the character of God which we have in us. We don't have to sit back as though we don't know any better. There are standards that we take with us everywhere we go, even as children of God. And so God has always, through history, and this kept the saints, this kept the slaves, this kept other generations of people holding on to, even the patriarchs of Hebrews chapter 11. The Bible says they all died in faith, and if you look at the account over there, some of them were really going through, if you will, and they died at the hands of their oppressors, but they kept the faith. And that's very important. And so I believe that throughout our generations, the faith aspect has grabbed the hearts and minds of many, not just the slaves, but humanity as a whole. All of us have seen this throughout history, that our faith has to hold and has to keep us through these trying times that we are living in. And so we just want to be able to understand that God is a God of all generations. And so He sees everything that we are doing and why we are doing these things. And we just have to be encouraged today. And so many have paved the way for us to be and to do what we are doing today. And we have to now pave the way for the generations who are coming behind us, in terms of keeping the faith and making sure we help our children and our grandchildren understand that God is a God of purpose. God is a God of deliverance, and we just have to hold these principles. And history shows us, biblical history as well as general history, shows us that God has always moved in the lives of His people that has been handed down to us to carry on. So we want to be encouraged by that today. And then our last outline is entitled, "Who Am I?" This is taken from Exodus chapter 3, verses 10 through 12. And I want to read this from the NIV translation. "So now go, I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? Verse 12, And God said, I will be with you, and this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. So we see a little twist here. Moses says, Here I am. And then he turns around and says, Who am I? So he is backing up. He is not wanting to be in the spotlight, if you will, having second thoughts, second mindsets, if you will, about this call. And that happens to us today. But in verse 10, God left no doubt. He told Moses that he was sending him to deliver his chosen people from Egypt. Moses would not have to go through the back door. God was sending Moses directly to the Egyptian Pharaoh. So let's consider possible thoughts. At first, he was probably pleased with God's divine intervention for Israel. However, it was one thing for Moses to view God's deliverance in the abstract, but an entirely different thing when Moses realized that he would be the one leading Israel's deliverance. How would Moses react to this news? And so, since this is a type of Christ in this story, as we're looking at through Moses, we can see the willingness of Christ. I want you to read Philippians chapter 2 when you have time. But we see the willingness of Christ to come and be the sacrifice and to give his life, to shed his blood for many. And Moses is in a great position here, but he doesn't consider how great this call is that is on his life and is one that he can't get out of. And so we just have to understand when we give our lives to Christ, when we submit to the will of God, when you come to Christ, we don't know what God may do. We don't know how he may raise you. I want you to read Joel chapter 2. We just don't know what God's will is in terms of what he wants us to do. But in time, he will reveal that to you. And he is certainly doing that with Moses. And then Jesus knew his purpose for coming, which was to seek and to save that which was lost. And so this prophet and Moses, God is giving him an assignment. As I said earlier, it's very important that you know what it is that the Lord wants you to do, and then be about that purpose, be about that call, be about what the Lord has given you to do. Go in the authority of God, go in the authority of God's will and his purpose for your life, and you will find things working better for you when you're doing them according to the dictation of the Holy Spirit. But Moses gets into an exchange with God. Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And always we should always remember that God has already considered who you are and what you are, your strengths, your weaknesses, your ups, your downs. It, you know, and so to compensate for an 80-year-old man who doesn't believe he can go, he's doubting, he has a speech issue. And so what God is letting him know in verse 12, I will be with you. So let's unpack that a little bit. What does that mean for Moses if God's saying, I'm going to be with you? So his will is there, his grace is there, his purpose is there, his protection is there. Everything that Moses needs to get the job done is why God is going with him. He's not sending Moses in the battle alone or in the deliverance alone. He's going with him. And so you can always be assured. Didn't Jesus say that to his disciples in the Great Commission, at least in Matthew 28, after he gives them instructions? He says, "And lo, I will be with you." So we can always expect God's presence and purpose. And that's what we have to be encouraged with. And you will feel that. And you will understand that God is there. And so he will remind you that he is with you. I was thinking about even Jesus' wilderness experience in Matthew chapter 4 and even in Luke chapter 4, when he was thrust out into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. But the Bible helps us understand that the Holy Spirit was with him. And so we are never alone in this. And that's what I love. That keeps me encouraged when I'm doing things that God has have assigned at my hands to do. And what we have to learn how to do is lean on that and feed off of that and get God's help, and because he's there to help, he's there to guide, he's there to teach, and everything else that comes with the presence and the purpose of God, things that we can't even describe. But just know that the power of God is present with you. And that's what God is telling Moses here, and he says in verse 12, after he says, "I will be with you," then he says, "And this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you." That's very important. So you don't need another sign. You have the sign. God is already there. He's with you. The sign is, "I'm with you." The sign is, "I'm not going to leave you. I'm not going to forsake you." And so we have to lean on that, and God will walk you through the process as he's doing here with Moses. But I don't minimize in the Garden of Gethsemane. It got tough for Jesus, and it got tough for Jesus in the fifth chapter of the book of Hebrews, if you go over there and you read that. So we have these moments where we back up and we don't feel adequate to do the things that God have called us to do. But I just want to say this to you today: he won't change his mind. If it's you, it's going to be you. If he's called you to do something, he will not change his mind. And I can see Moses trying to back up and get out of this thing, but God has set this revelation in motion here. So Moses, even at 80 years old, he can't get out of this thing. And so that's very important for you to understand. And God will keep working with you, and he will keep poking you, if you will, and he will keep reminding you that he has not changed his mind. And so I just want you to be encouraged today and step out on that, the fact that God chose you to be a part of his great work. Thank God that he saved you and sanctified you, as he's done here with Moses, and equipping him to do something for him. Thank God that he didn't leave me and leave you in our sins, but he has something for us to do. And thank God that we're not the puzzle, we're just a piece of the puzzle. And so, but all of this story here, as I said earlier, goes back to the promise that God made, and he's going to keep his promises, even as he did with Abraham. But the question is asked here in the quarterly, keeping in mind that God will call us to do his will on earth, why do we often not feel worthy of his call in our lives? That's a very good question. Well, we look at all of the natural attributes. We look at who we are, and we don't feel as though we have enough education, we have enough experience, we have enough, we don't have enough money, we don't whatever the list is that we have, but it doesn't change the fact that God called you, period. God knew and he knows what you have and what you don't have. But we have to learn how to be more reliant. I was thinking about, the Spirit of the Lord was reminding me about 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Read those when you get time, because you know, it can be an overwhelming experience, but if we can just get away from who we think we are and set our gaze on what God says you are, you will be better served. And these are things that we are learning each and every day, because God calls us to step out and fulfill big roles, and sometimes that catches us off guard. But it doesn't change the fact that, yes, God wants you. Yes, God wants you to go and do something for him, or to speak or on his behalf. God may want you to do a number of things. And so, as I said, if it's you that he called, he will not change his mind. And so here are the closing prayers offered for this lesson. Lord God, we admit that we sometimes get so busy in making requests of you until we are unable to hear your voice in response. We wonder what we have missed out on because we are simply too busy. Forgive us, Lord. We are going to pause even now just to listen to you. Is there anything you want us to do today? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. That's a very powerful question. Is there anything you want us to do? We know there is. And so be prepared when you ask that question of God and he gives you an assignment that now you are responsible for what you heard, and you are responsible for fulfilling what you heard. And so we have to bear these things in mind and be mindful of the sacrifices of a call. I wish I had time to deal with that today, because Moses at 80 years old has to make great sacrifices in his life to fulfill the command and the call of God on his life. And sometimes we're not prepared to deal with the sacrifices that's associated with the call, and sometimes that causes us to back up. But just know there will be some sacrifices. There will be some consecration, some dedication in your life that you will have to make to fulfill these roles that God have called you. You're going to lose out on some things, if you will, maybe some relationships and some things that you enjoy doing. God may call you away from those things for a while and get you ready for what he wants you to do, and go with him. I can say this from personal experience. I've had some very crushing sacrifices that I have made in my life to be where I am this day, and it hurts sometimes, but God still encourages us, and I just thank God that he saw me through those difficult days, and he is still there to help me through difficult days. And so I just want you to be encouraged today that you may be the next one that God calls to do something great. And so I just want to remind you that as all of us, as members of the body of Christ, we have various functions, and God will continue to fulfill his promises as he has made them to all of us. So I hope, trust, and pray that you've been encouraged by this lesson. Until such time that the Lord will permit us to come together again, we say God bless you.